A short time ago, in a laboratory, at least 10 minutes' drive away, something far-fetched is going on. Professor Dweeb is trying to create something, something that will ultimately become me, in fact.
Come in, come in. I've been waiting for you. Well, not for you, actually, just for someone. No, don't bother trying to get out. The security cameras that picked you up are linked into the whole security system. All the doors and gates are locked now. Anyway, as we're waiting for her to come back, I can tell you a long, drawn-out story that isn't true. It's all about me. I don't recall much about the early days. Most of my initial recollections seem to come from the backup memory stored on the main pane. It's a hazy scene that comes to mind. A laboratory, obscured in the shadows of underachievement and disappointment, gave shape and form to the badly postured figure of Professor Dweeb.
Oh, bloody hell, I'm broke.
When you Right, now we seem to have ironed out all the bugs. Let's have a go, shall we? Sing! That's enough. Pose!
I'm too sexy for my shirt. Too sexy for my shirt. So sexy it hurts.
Enough. Very good, by the way. Most important, interview mode. Superb. superb. Real, moody, enigmatic, and completely vacuous angst there. Right, finally, choreography. Well, 3 out of 4 ain't bad. Right, my friend. That's all the hard work over with. Time to record. I'd better get a top producer.
Fusion unstable. Fusion unstable. Alien DNA. Unstable. Unstable. Unstable.
We've tracked down a producer, credited on one of the albums from his vintage collection, by the name Has Been, currently residing in luxurious obscurity, and decided rather than paying him, he'd employ alternative methods of persuasion.
After all, who do you think set up the photocall with the sun when you went on that 18 to 30 happy humping holiday?
You bastard! You know I was the youngest one there! How'd you feel about your first hit being a duet?
Na 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 na.
And in no time at all, we knew we had a hit.
At the third stroke, the time sponsored by Accurist will be...
We'll be right back.
Of course, the point of this extravagant exercise was to get rich. So the first thing Dweeb had to do was dispense with Hasbeen. Not, of course, taking into account the fact that he was responsible for the band's only record.
Droid.
Droid?
Yes, I call him Droid for short. Dispose of this person.
You'll never make it without me.
I have the hit. I have the artist. What more do I need?
A friend who's a top record company executive.
Oh, bloody hell. In that case, I'll take you to the DJs.
Despite his repulse, next came the ritual humiliation of dragging this uninspiring assemblage to the record companies. Mr. 5 points gave Professor Dweeb the grilling of a lifetime.
Does the enemy like it?
They love it.
This sounds exciting. Is there lots of youthful energy?
No, youthful energy is out. The kids don't like it anymore. But there is a speaking clock.
At the third stroke, the time sponsored by Accurist will be...
Just love that clock.
Unfortunately for Dweeb's plans, Amelia appeared totally captivated by the trite banality of this former office girl known as BB. That and the fact that she was considerably more photogenic than I was. So how to extricate my career from hers? This point became increasingly urgent as we just won an award for best use of hair product in a promotional video, at exactly the same time the press became increasingly focused on who was actually singing on the single.
Ever since the Spice Girls burst onto the scene, pop music has become inundated with similar groups acting out a variation on the theme. Today, it seems you can't turn on the chart show without seeing yet another collection of scantily clad females energetically bouncing around to the pop sounds of their latest backing track. But has the market become saturated with these bubblegum feminists?
Some, like new female artist BB, who feel that girl power does for feminism what the Sinclair C5 did for fast motoring.
I met up with BB in North London, where she was filming the video for her latest track, Mindless, which she describes as an acrid response to the plethora of girl groups currently being promoted around the industry.
What are you actually trying to say with this record?
Well, I'm trying to say that I've had enough of selling crap, you know, and if crap is out there to be sold, then I'm here to try it, but on a kind of funny level that, you know, I wrote the song myself and I'm just saying, you know, hey girls, there's not much girl power and you're not doing anything for yourselves.
Spicy, spicy, very pricey, I say, manamana, no brain, no brain.
Some people might say that the reason you've made this record is due to the fact these groups are very successful. Is that in fact the case?
Well, if they're very successful, that's good, but we're not talking about real ability and talent. We're talking about the A&R, being able to promote and sell it.
What about the new breed of girl group like Hepburn, who apparently play their own instruments? Would you say that's better?
Yeah, marginally better. I mean, I don't know how much marketing went behind them, but certainly the fact that they play their instruments is a good thing, because that's showing a positive sign to the younger generation to go out there and bloody well take charge.
You wouldn't join a girl group yourself then, if it was very successful?
Well, for the money, you know, to have my picture on a packet crisp, I suppose, to be that kind of stuck in somebody's house that, you know, I'm part of the furniture, then yeah, why not? But on the big things, I wouldn't probably be able to sleep very well, no.
It was now necessary to utilise the acumen of Hasbeen. Whilst the band was busy promoting the single, Dweeb had eviscerated his corpse and plugged his neocortex into the mainframe, appearing totally oblivious to the dangers that a now revenge-bent machine was assisting his plan. He began to quiz the music biz hack.
Breaking news! D-roid has communicated through its management that it has decided to quit the group Mistake to concentrate on quote-unquote serious music. The creature is currently working on its solo album, The Secret Universe of Azaleas. Meanwhile, Mistake has a new member, Asher.
Has been correctly surmised that bringing in a new, equally attractive female who had talent and a personality would finish the band. And within 3 weeks, Mistake was consigned to the dustbin of ITV20's So You Think You Can Be Famous Again.
Imagine, you're a DHSS private investigator by day and aspiring singer by night. And then you find yourself transported into a two-dimensional girl group. You have entered the mindless.
Party, I can sleep at night. Mixed emotions.
Pop stars Mistake attempt to manufacture a revival in their new programme, Mistake Takes on Watford. Programme that aims to resurrect ancient pop stars from 5 minutes ago. This week's episode features Asher, and will she rejoin her old band Mistake after her terrible ordeal with Biscuit Addiction?
In the meantime, D-roid needed a backing band. Having learned almost nothing from his previous experience, we've decided to create a band in his now infamous and slightly plagiarized creation pod. He downloaded all the DNA profiles available on the World Wide Web, and in an entirely arbitrary manner, picked names that he quite liked, checking he had the right instrument from Hasbeen's advice. We failed to notice, of course, the fact that the genetic material was obtained from the Comacola Guantanamo Bay Penitentiary. Relying on the efficiency of a retarded computer and the homicidal remains of a hate-filled producer, he left the machine to the several hours of processing and then went to bed. Feeling he had done a good day's work, and this last assumption alone should indicate that for a maniacal scientific genius, Dwee wasn't really very bright. Rather than standing on the shoulders of giants, he appeared to be standing on the shoulders of garden gnomes. And this, coincidentally, was the last name of the first creature to pop out in a rather disgusting placental blob on the lower laboratory floor. Screaming for pints of lager and women in alternate order, it was the metronome. Then, out they all popped. The members of the Big Funk Factory. Of course, ignoring Dweeb and in the background Hasbeen, the record company insisted that the first solo single was a cover version. They put these weird clothes over my plasticated body and let my diminishing follicle resources grow. Yep, it was about as successful as the reworking of New Kids on the Block.
All over the place.
We will, we will rock you.
after successfully sabotaging the record company's attempt to release We Will Rock You by sneaking Uptown Blues to every DJ he could find and getting them to play that instead, Dwee woke to a new problem. To his horror, he began to realise his creation was decomposing. It wasn't noticeable at first, but it was definitely getting older and older. Damn, he thought, that's the pop market done with. We'll have to sell it to the easy-listening aficionados instead. They don't mind an ageing rock star singing something soulful.
You don't know what's going on in this river.
Things were going a little wonky. BB decided to reappear, demanding royalties from the song she didn't sing or write, threatening to broadcast Has-Been's involvement rather than go through a lengthy court case. Professor Dweeb chose more direct action.
But how that Professor Dweeb had disposed of all witnesses?
Ow! Really?
If luck and convenient dramatic device would have it, the record company got one of my tracks featured on an Atenolol advertisement, and I was in the charts again.
He was ready to engineer my success, take all the credit and the profit. Everything was going according to plan.
and pay that bet.
So what had happened? What had gone right? Back in his laboratory, Professor Dweeb began muttering to himself.
Mutter, mutter, mutter.
In less audible tones than that.
Mutter, mutter, mutter.
He then began to analyze how this metamorphosis, this regeneration of his pop creation, had occurred.
How on earth did this happen? How did this degeneration of my pop creation occur?
Regeneration.
It must be in the crystalline gnomic structure.
And in no time at all, at the expense of what minuscule scientific credibility the script might have had, Dweeb had worked out the problem.
Dandruff!
And with a sudden flashback far too cinematic and difficult to arrange for a meager budget show such as this, Dweeb remembered stepping out of the pod with a lock of his hair gently falling away from his head, and somehow not noticing the absence of his hairpiece, started the creation sequence stolen from too many sci-fi film sequels to mention, merging his DNA-ridden dandruff with that of his creation, D-roid, and the rest, his misery. He then hit upon a second plan, which, considering his track record, was probably ill-advised, but necessary to continue the obvious dramatic tension.
I'll make a second D-roid. Command 1, destroy Dweeb Droid.
I'm sorry, could you speak up? I didn't catch that.
Oh, great, you understand.
Nam, Yoho Ringi, Kuo.
Command 1, destroy Dweeb Droid.
Ah, juicy fruit. What does Dweeb Droid look like?
Well, me of course, but with better hair. Well, me, of course, but with better hair.
So, you want D-roid to destroy someone who looks like you?
For some reason, I'm dumbly unaware of what's coming, but yes.
Righty-ho, you are certain of this, aren't you?
Yes. Ha! I didn't type that answer in, did I? Oh, all right, just for you and the sake of the plot. Yes.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure to work for such a thoughtful controller.
That last track we heard was Window Shopping by the Big Funk Factory, and in fact, in the studio today, we have Dweeb Droid from the Big Funk Factory. Hello, Dweeb.
Hello.
Can I ask you, you recently emerged as the reconstructed Dweeb Droid on the lottery, and I wondered what had happened to Professor Dweeb since your very public breakup.
Well, I'm afraid I don't think he's available for the next foreseeable future, yes.
Right, and what happened to Asher?
That's very sad, actually, because after she was brought in to replace me in mistake, And then, for some reason, the band split up. She tried to set up her own solo career with her single I Need You, and that didn't go very well. And yes, it's tragic, really. She's, well, she ended up on I'm a Non-Entity, Get Me Out of Here. And then, to add insult to injury, she then went on that program for ITV20, The Regrouping, where they tried to build up the careers of people whose careers ended about 5 minutes ago. Yeah, it's very sad.
Right, yes. What about BB? She seems to have disappeared.
Yes, I'm afraid I don't know anything about that at all. No.
No, okay. It's rumoured, with quite substantial evidence from the singer Yaz, that she didn't sing on Mindless.
Well, I'm afraid, you know, you must remember I was D-roid at the time and I didn't have anything to do with the production of the record, so I'm afraid I can't give you any help on that at all.
Well, okay. Well, let's just play the track anyway. And that last track was Mindless by the Big Funk Factory. I still have Dweeb Droid in the studio. Dweeb, I wondered, what about Uptown? My sources tell me the record company wanted to release another record, a cover of We Will Rock You.
Yes, that's right. And they even did a video with me in some rather strange clothes and not really looking like me at all. But yes, it's very strange, really. The master somehow ended up in the cutting room at Abbey Road, and so they cut it, and then somehow it ended up at the factory and got many, many reproductions of it done. It was pressed. I don't quite know how that happened at all. And then, bizarrely, Professor Dweeb, who, of course, was my manager at the time, just inadvertently gave out the wrong record to various DJs and put it on the internet. We're not quite sure how any of this happened, but then, of course, it committed the record company to that. There was a bit of a kerfuffle, but it ended up okay in the end.
Right. Well, one question then. Is it true D-roid can't actually speak?
Well, you see, he's programmed to communicate in the medium of song, as we know. But it was also designed in his brain not to have any excessive verbal communication, or in fact any verbal communication at all, in order to preserve the longevity of his career. That's also why he's not allowed to dance.
Right, and well, what's next for this previously mute superstar?
Ah, well, of course, with the success of the Antenolol advert, which has pushed the success of the single through the roof, as it were, until my moment of rebirth, we now have got various things. We've got the new single coming out, and then a big tour, and who knows, maybe even a film. You can never tell.
Right. Can you perhaps enlighten us then on the allegations of your playing regressive rock to animals?
No, I'm sorry. I did say to your producer we can't discuss this particular matter. It's sub judice, and in fact, I think in fact it's better if we just end the interview now. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Well, thank you. It appears Dweeb Droid has left the studio, so let's play D-Roid's first solo hit, Uptown Blues.
But once outside in the real world, D-Roid too didn't really know what to do with himself. After all, What value in society is there for a merciless cyborg who sings and can't dance? Of course, he goes on a talent show. He lost, obviously.
Right, who are you then?
We are children of the world.
No, cretin. What's your name?
We are children of the world.
Oh, God, just get on with it. Ghastly media creation, Freddy Nonwit, glazed with self-importance, presided over his multimedia empire. No one was quite sure where he came from, but after an associate offered him the opportunity that no one wanted to be a judge on a naff talent show, he rose like a load of phage material out of an unwanted colonoscopy. Known in the music industry as Freddy Nonwit, no talent, he decided to make this his catchphrase, and then, against all advice, decided to eliminate all the other judges on the show. As he sits, plasticine-faced, in a fossilized state, Nonwit's origins are revealed for only the back of the dressing room wall to see. For the truth about the origin of this popular culture demagogue was that it was actually the first biological fusion experiment of our very own Dr. Susan Hall. Freddy Nonwit, no talent. He decided to make this his catchphrase, and then, against all advice, decided to eliminate all the other judges on the show. As he sits, plasticine-faced, in a fossilized state, Nonwit origins are revealed for only the back of the dressing room wall to see. For the truth about the origin of this popular culture demagogue, that it was actually the first biological fusion experiment of our very own.
Yes, the time is upon us, but now it's here. You've been waiting impatiently, and here it comes. A dweeb in hand, starring Dweeb Droid. Out on general release throughout the world from July onwards. You so notified.
With that, D-roid 2's quest had begun. He had found a new purpose in life. My annihilation.
And finally, tonight news of a major rift between Dweeb and the multi-billion dollar drinks company Lewd. After Dweeb's arrest today, when his video recorder taken in full repair contained a video showing the pop star in bed with a pedigree poodle following a 4-hour session of playing note for note Frank Zappa's guitar solos, Dweeb was bailed from King's Cross magistrates having pleaded guilty to the charge of contravening RSPCA laws regarding the mistreatment of animals. Lewd has publicly stated that it will not be associated with such retrograde and debased behaviour. It is rumoured Dweeb was also found in possession of several Emerson, Lake and Palmer albums and other bands named after disreputable firms of solicitors. Dweeb said he would be suing Lewd and threatened to switch his contract to their major competitor, Coca-Cola. Lewd executive Praise God Barebone Sherman said the board's decision was final. It appears Dweeb was just too lewd for Lewd.
Okay, Howie, on my mark, lights up. Allie? Christ, where the hell is he? Oh, somebody get the lights up! Jesus!
I know that a lot of you have heard about my recent case, but I just want you to know, even though I pleaded guilty, I am actually innocent. Now I'm going to sing a song dedicated to those people responsible for fitting me up.
Right. Is the platform up? No, too high. But wait a minute. Okay, bring it down.
This is the early evening slot with me, Jay Renault. Not the French car. For those of you not aware, the megastar dweeb has been brutally slain before a crowd of thousands. Now that's showmanship. Anita Rika is on the scene. Anika, how is it down there?
It's pandemonium down by the stage. People are running around, bumping into each other for no apparent reason.
Can anyone give a reason for the shooting?
Some people are suggesting that the Music Lovers Association club together to hire an assassin. Apparently, there are a number of unknown dweeb recordings that have been found missing.
Found missing? Well, all art is theft. What would be the purpose of stealing them?
Oh, well, possibly to sell them for millions, J.A., or much less intelligently to try and pass them off as the culprit's own work, claiming he or she recorded them and thus attempt to obtain a record deal.
No!
Oh, no.
Oh. Still following the biggest entertainment story of the decade. Yes, not much has happened in the past 10 years. The tapes of Dweeb that were found missing in his former home, a demolished laboratory. Our roving nose, Anika Rika, is outside one of the leading recording company's offices, Minimalist Records.
Actually, the company is now known as Lowest Common Denominator Records, since it's a takeover to DJ.
I told you that's J without the E. So, what's happening, Anika?
Well, it appears that someone has been attempting to obtain a record contract using these tapes, but as no one has actually bothered to listen to the cassettes, he's not having much luck.
Do we know the name of this culprit?
Yes, apparently he goes under the name of D-roid.
That name sounds familiar.
That's right, Jade. That was what Dweeb was called when he was formerly known as Talented.
It's pretty stupid of him to try and get a record deal from a record company. Doesn't he know he should be at a music solicitor if he wants a deal?
Apparently not. In any case, it's pretty stupid of him trying to pass himself off as a forgotten pop star. I mean, D-Roid's moment of fame was at least 2 weeks ago. I was gonna interview somebody at LSD, but they were too busy to see me, so instead I've asked this person walking past the building to be interviewed. In any case, ordinary people are much more interesting, aren't they? What was your reaction to the idea of signing a D-Roid lookalike?
Well, we don't mind lookalikes, but D-Roid's so old-bit now.
Old-bit, of course! It's part of the new teenage slang, mostly spoken by 40-year-old television executives who commission youth programming. Back to you, Jay.
Thanks, Annika, for that in-depth interview. There are significant reports suggesting that after his dismal failure at obtaining a record deal, his last known attempt was with the original executive who signed D-Roid, who is no longer with that company, our D-Roid lookalike has been forced into the dismal expedient of playing live and in a pub.
Here we go. One of London's premier live venues.
PA.
This is the drug that is
here for you and me. And the world comes tumbling down as the debris kills flames. Flames crown.
Having tracked down my nemesis and avoided him killing me several times, I explained that I was in fact very grateful for the opportunity of faking my own death to get out of the various legal actions amassing in every direction. I had decided to take a back seat. I became his manager. The first thing I thought we needed was to write something suitably bland that we could get a mimsy-sounding singer to cover for the S&M's next Christmas campaign. But then I thought we may as well just let D-roid sing it.
Late one night. tracks we'll leave when we finally turn around.
My friends, it's time for you to know the full story. Well, a bit more anyway. You probably noticed the pre-immersion chamber that's surrounding you and the electrolyte fluids that are maintaining your pre-analysis state, which effectively means that I'm talking to myself as you're almost entirely comatose. However, my programming prohibits me to reflect on the futility of completing this part of the journey. As you may recall, D-roid, myself, and D-roid Mark II were created by the now-deceased Professor Dweeb, and there may be some questions that arose from my previous interminable diatribe. For instance, how did I manage to survive the fairly extensive head wound caused by D-roid 2's attack? Quite simply, I didn't. Or rather, the clone cyborg designed by our true creator didn't. For it must have occurred to you that Dweeb's fundamental lack of practical sense would have bled into his abilities as a successful scientist. And of course he wasn't one. And so to the crux. 7 years ago, an extremely talented but somewhat ruthless and tunnel-visioned scientist by the name of Professor Wen had her genetic research cut due to budgetary considerations relating to its practical application and ethical issues. The Coca-Cola organization shut down its entire human genome cloning and robotics facility after the rather disastrous examples that were currently languishing in their penal institution, and Wen's lab was left to face the revenge of nature. Unbeknownst to them, she then returned to recommence her research, which you recently have so kindly, if somewhat unknowingly,
contributed to. The upshot of all this misguided activity was the appearance of the genetic cyborg, Freddy Nonwit. After he'd been successfully integrated into popular culture, she was emboldened by her efforts, and so added to her many calumnies by creating Professor Dweeb, programming in him an insatiable desire to conquer the media world and reflect her own strange obsessions. Obviously, we've seen lack of success in this direction, but worse still, Dweeb's incompetence unleashed both an uncontrolled clone, me, and D-roid 2, plus the homicidal mainframe, computer. Everything that has followed has been Wen's attempt to tidy up these rather messy results. Although D-roid Mark II destroyed a large part of the lab, which at least got rid of Hasbeen's influence by destroying the original mainframe, she still needed to find a way to get rid of the other unsanctioned creations, and that is what I am currently engaged in. Thanks so much for being patient. I feel the first part of this endless saga is drawing to its inevitable conclusion.
Now on my show, the exclusive everyone has been waiting for, D-Roid's first ever interview. So, D-Roid, we've all been anxious to hear what you really sound like when you talk. How about saying a medium-sized hello to the studio audience?
Now that's a career move. Career move.
Thank you.